Hello there, welcome to Unique History Channel. Tonight, we'll be doing a reading from The Israeli Solution by Caroline Glick, and we'll be reading Chapter 13, Indigenous People, Not Colonial Usurpers. So let's jump in. In June 2012, the New York Times published an article about a Palestinian village south of Jerusalem called Baitar, which hopes to recognize as a World Heritage Site by UNESCO and the UN's Educational Fund, Scientific and Cultural Organization. Baitar bases its bid on its ancient irrigation system and traced terraced agriculture. According to the Palestinians and UNESCO, the system in question is a Roman-era irrigation system. The Times account was right to describe the irrigation as an ancient wonder. From then on, the article was at best problematic. The Palestinian and UNESCO account, unquestionably reported by the Times, attributes the irrigation system, the ancient agriculture, and the historic significance of the village to the wrong era and the wrong historical actors. Baitar is the Arabized name of the ancient Jewish town of Baitar. Baitar was the last stronghold held by Jews in the land of Israel during their final great revolt against the Roman conquerors, from 132 to 135. During those 3 years, Jewish warriors led by Simon Bar Kochaba destroyed 2 Roman legions. Bar Kochaba's fortress was located inside Baitar. The historical significance of Baitar is not the advanced irrigation system that the Jews built there, or the advanced agricultural technique of terrace farming that they developed. That irrigation system and the village's proximity to Jerusalem and to natural water sources generally were among the reasons Bar Kochaba chose to locate his headquarters in Baitar. The village's historical significance is that it was the last place in the land of Israel where the Jews would exercise sovereignty for the next 1,813 years, from its fall in 135 until establishment of Israel in 1948. Baitar is popularly known as Kehir Biat El Yahud, or the Jewish Ruin. After finally defeating Bar Kochaba's forces, according to Josephus, the eventual Roman forces killed 1.1 million Jews in the land of Israel. In addition, 97,000 were taken as prisoner. In the light of the Roman genocide of Jewry, the Talmud claimed that the source of the village's fertility was not the irrigation system, but something else. In the rabbi's telling, for 7 years after the fall of Baitar, the Gentiles fertilized their vineyards with the blood of Israel without using manure. It is not surprising that UNESCO would collude with the Palestinian Authority to expropriate Jewish history in the land of Israel for the Palestinians. In October 2012, UNESCO condemned Israel for designating Rachel's tomb in Bethlehem and the Patriarch's tomb in Hebron as national heritage sites. Instead, UNESCO declared that the tombs of the biblical Jewish patriarchs and matriarchs were mosques. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu harshly condemned the UN agency, saying, "The attempt to separate the nation of Israel from its cultural heritage is absurd." His office's formal condemnation read, "It is unfortunate that an organization that established it with the goal of promoting cultural preservation of historical sites around the world is attempting to do political reasons to uproot the connection between the nation of Israel and its cultural heritage." UNESCO, the only UN agency that accepts Palestine as a member of it, as a member state, though so no such state exists, does not limit its cultural assault to Jews in Israel alone. It is active in a campaign to appropriate Jewish history as a whole to Islam. For example, in a report issued in 2006, the agency said the greatest Jewish theologian in history, Rabbi Moses Maimonides, the Rabbaham, was a Muslim, and in 2009, the agency labeled Jerusalem as a capital of Arab culture. UNESCO does not operate alone in this campaign. In March 2011, Turkish Prime Minister Recep Tayyip Erdogan told a Saudi newspaper that the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, the Cave of the Patriarchs, and Rachel's Tomb were not and never will be Jewish sites, but Islamic sites. Erdogan's statement is no different from those made by the Palestinian leaders, who act in accordance with the PLO's charter provision states, which claims of historical religious ties of Jews with Palestine are incompatible with the facts of history and the true concept of what constitutes statehood. Judaism, being a religion, is not an independent nationality. Nor do Jews constitute a single nation with an identity of its own. They are citizens of the states to which they belong. Palestinian Media Watch is an Israeli NGO that reports on official Palestinian media. Its reports have formed the basis of the U.S. congressional and EU probes of Palestinian incitement against Israel. PMW, Palestinian Media Watch, has documented the Palestinian Authority's denial of Jewish history and of the Jewish connection to the Land of Israel began with its establishment in 1994. Two, the Palestinian Media Watch has documented how Palestinians have systematically fabricated history in order to appropriate Jewish history to themselves. Among other things, they've claimed that Jesus was a Palestinian Muslim, and that the Jebusites, Canaanites, Philistines, and Jews of the Bible were Arab Palestinian Muslims, even though the final books of the Bible were written nearly 1,000 years before the creation of Islam. At a 1998 academic conference organized by the Palestinian Authority, PMW reports Palestinian academics openly admitted the goal of rewriting history is to deny all Jewish political rights to Israel and to appropriate Jewish history to the Palestinians. The official Palestinian newspaper El Ayama, reported on December 4, 1998, Dr. Yusuf Elamazia, chairman of the history department at Khan Yunis Educational College, called on all the universities and colleges to write the history of Palestine to guard it and not enable the foreign implants and enemies to distort it or to legitimize the existence of Jews on this land. History lecturer Abu Amar clarified there is no connection between the ancient generation of Jews and the new generation. In keeping with this position, Yasser Arafat, Mahmoud Abbas, Salam Fayyad, and all major and other minor Palestinian officials and Palestinian religious leaders deny that Jews have a national history in the Land of Israel. For example, at the July 2000 Camp David summit, Arafat told President Bill Clinton there had never been a Jewish temple in Jerusalem, and he insisted there had never been a Jewish temple. It was in Nablus or in Yemen. In August 2012, Abbas issued a statement accusing Israel of seeking to destroy El Aqsa Mosque, which is the first Muslim conquerors of the Land of Israel in the 7th century built on the ruins of the Second Temple, denied the existence of any Jewish settlement in Jerusalem, and referred to the temple in all language typical of Palestinians' historical discourse as the alleged temple. In the same statement, Abbas threatened Israel with a return to war if it did not remove its Jewish citizens and surrender its sovereignty over Jerusalem. There will be no peace or stability, he said, before our beloved city and eternal capital is liberated from occupation and settlement. Abbas proclaimed that the city, which has served as the capital of the Jewish people for the past 3,000 years, has never been the capital for any other people, and forever be Arab, Islamic, and Christian. For his part, in April 2010, Palestinian Prime Minister Salam Fayyad formally requested that Canada's Prime Minister canceled an exhibition of the Dead Sea Scrolls at Toronto's Royal Ontario Museum. The Dead Sea Scrolls were found in 1946 and in 1956 in caves near the Dead Sea in Judea, and contain the earliest known copies of the Bible. They date from the time of the Second Temple and include fragments from the books of Genesis, Psalms, and Deuteronomy, among others. Among other things, the Dead Sea Scrolls are further proof of the historic and religious ties that the Jewish people have to Israel. Fayyad alleged that the scrolls had been stolen by Israel and were Palestinian property. He asked that the Canadian officials seize the scroll and transfer them to the Palestinian Authority. He insisted that the sovereignty over the Dead Sea belongs to the Palestinian Authority. The Jordanians also weighed in, insisting that the Canadian authorities seize the scrolls and transfer them to Jordan. As we saw in the previous chapter, neither the Palestinian Authority nor Jordan has ever legally exercised sovereignty over Judea and Samaria, including the Dead Sea region. Yet, as the scholar David Meyer Levy explained from a political standpoint, the fact that Fayyad's claim have no basis in law or history made no difference whatsoever. What was supposed to be the cultural exhibition of early biblical texts from the lands of their origin became a political event in which Israel's very history was criminalized and demonized. On May 14, 2011, on the eve of the 63rd anniversary of Israel's Declaration of Independence, Abbas proclaimed, "We say to him, Netanyahu, when he claims that the Jews have historical right dating back to 3,000 years BCE, we say that the nation of Palestine upon the land of Canaan has 7-year history BCE. This is the truth which must be understood, and we must note it in order to say, Netanyahu, you are incidental in history, we are the people of history." Like his claim that Jerusalem is the internal capital of the Palestinian people, Abbas's statement is a clear example of the Palestinians' shameless denial of historical fact. The Arabs never attributed religious or political significance to Jerusalem until the Jews reasserted sovereignty over the city in 1967. It is easy to understand why the Palestinians believe it is imperative that they deny Jewish history. If they acknowledge the validity of the region's Jewish root, they would force to recognize that the Jews rather than the Palestinian Arabs are the indigenous people of the land. The state of affairs is so obvious that even the PLO has admitted it. In January 2011, Al Jazeera and The Guardian published what they referred to as the Palestine Papers. The papers leaked to Al Jazeera were in part written by the Palestinian Negotiation Support Unit. The NUS is the Palestinian Authority Department responsible for packaging and marketing the Palestinians' negotiation positions. The leaked papers included thousands of documents. One of the leaked documents, titled Strategy and Talking Points for Responding to the Precondition of Recognizing Israel as a Jewish State. In the document, the NSU explained that the Palestinian negotiations must never recognize Israel's right to exist as a Jewish state. Instructed Palestinian negotiators to limit their recognition of the fact of Israel's existence as a sovereign state. In an appendix, the NSU explained why the Palestinians must never extend any recognition to Israel's Jewish identity. Recognizing Israel as a Jewish state, particularly in advance of agreeing to the final border between Israel and Palestine, could also strengthen Israel's claim to sovereignty over all of historic Palestine, including the occupied Palestinian territory. Recognizing the Jewish state implies the recognition of a Jewish people and a recognition of its rights to self-determination. Those who assert this right also assert the territory historically associated with this with the right of self-determination. Right of self-determination is all of historic Palestine. Therefore, recognition of the Jewish people and their right of self-determination may lead to credence to the Jewish people's claim of all of historic Palestine. So for the Palestinians, even the most basic recognition of reality that Israel is a Jewish state threatens their entire edifice of lies. One must refuse to recognize the existence of the Jewish people, they say, for once you recognize the Jewish people, you recognize their history, which in turn requires you to recognize that Jews are the only nation that has ever claimed the land of Israel as its homeland and the only people that has ever claimed Jerusalem as its capital. Indeed, acknowledging the reality of the Jewish existence in history would require Palestinians and their supporters to behave as the framers of the League of Nations mandate for Palestine did. That is, it would force them to recognize that Jews are the indigenous people of the land of Israel, including Judea and Samaria. And in that, the words of the NSU, the Jews' right to self-determination, is all of historic Palestine. Israel's national rights to Judea and Samaria. In truth, the Jewish people's rights to sovereignty over Judea and Samaria, as are their rights to the rest of the land of Israel, are overwhelming. From a historical and political perspective, during the 3,500-year political history of the land of Israel, the Jews were the only nation that viewed Israel as a single political unit. Separate and distinct from all other territory, as the territory uniquely served as their national, political, and religious and territorial center. In an attempt to wipe out the Jewish identity of the land of Israel, the Romans renamed the area Palestina and incorporated it into the empire's Syria-Palestinian district. The name Palestinia was chosen because it connected the identity to the ancient Philistines who had ceased to exist hundreds of years before the Roman conquest. The Romans also changed the name of Jerusalem to Ilonia Capitolina and barred Jews from entering the newly pagan city. Until Jordan's illegal occupation and annexation of Judea and Samaria in 1949-1950, the areas have never been governed or viewed as a geological unit separate from the rest of the land of Israel. They were known by their historic Jewish names, Judea and Samaria, and the UN, for instance, referred to the area as Judea, Samaria and Judea in its 1947 partition resolution. Judea and Samaria came to be viewed as a distinct geographical unit only when the Jordanians instigated their occupations of the area. They invented the term West Bank in order to ground their claim for sovereignty on an intuitive but non-existent political link between the West Bank of the Jordan River and the East Bank of the river, which was Jordan. The Christians, who ruled the land from the Byzantines from 324 to 624 and again under the Crusaders from 1099 to 1291, did not view the area as a standalone state, but rather as a section of larger territorial unit. But the Holy Land was never considered the political center of Christendom. The political centers of Christendom were in Rome and Constantinople, and during the Crusader period, Jerusalem was one administrative center along with Antioch, Caesarea, and Damascus. Later, the forces of Islam would rule the land under three separate regimes. The Arabs ruled the land from 624 to 1099, the Mamluks ruled from 1291 to 1517, and the Ottoman Turks ruled from 1517 to 1917. During the millennia of Islamic rule, the land of Israel was never considered a unique geographical unit. Under all three regimes, the land of Israel was ruled from Damascus and was seen as a larger territorial unit spanned from the Levant. Although the League of Nations mandate referred to the land of Israel as Palestine, the League was clear that the name held no political significance. Rather, its purpose was simply to define a geographical entity. Palestine was not defined by history by geographical boundaries. The Palestinian attempts to convince the world that they are descendants of the biblical Philistines, Canaanites, Jews, and Moabites, and to supplant the Jews already an appropriate Jewish history is contradicted by the historical record revealed by every square inch of Israeli territory. Jewish history pervades the land's geography. Take Shiloh, a Jewish community in Judea. For example, modern Shiloh was established in 1978. If one were to accept the Palestinian claim that Jews have no history in Israel generally, specifically in Judea and Samaria, then it might be possible to accept the narrative that Shiloh and in all Jewish communities in Judea and Samaria is a colonial outpost of Israel, and that Israel is occupying the power for now destruction of the native Palestinians, and that the Palestinians are an indigenous people with a 7,000 or 9,000 year history in the land of Israel, depending on how Mahmoud Abbas and his colleagues are counting on any particular day. But like thousands of other places in Israel, especially those in Judea and Samaria, Shiloh exposes the utter bankruptcy of the Palestinian campaign to rewrite history. Shiloh was the Jewish people's first capital in the land of Israel. It is mentioned in the Bible 31 times, one in Genesis, and then in the books of Joshua, Samuel, Judges, Kings, Psalms, and Jeremiah. Shiloh is where Joshua divided the land among the 12 tribes of Israel. It is where he appropriated cities for the Levites and where he mobilized the armies of Israel. The tabernacle was erected in Shiloh. For hundreds of years before King David conquered Jerusalem and his son Solomon built the first temple, Shiloh was the home of the Ark of the Covenant, and the Jews made pilgrims there three times a year, bringing their offerings to God. In 1983, the renowned archaeologist Israel Finkelstein excavated much of the ancient Tell of Shiloh. He found a storage unit just a few dozen meters away from the presumed site of the tabernacle. The storage area contained nearly undisturbed storage trucks filled with remains of raisins and other organic materials that were apparently destined to serve as sacrificial offerings. Finkelstein conducted carbon-14 dating of organic materials, which dated to the jugs of the time of Samuel. The storage jugs were so well preserved because they were buried under a layer of scorched earth. According to Finkelstein, carbon-14 dating of corn grains found at the time indicated the fire took place around 1050 BCE, the time which the Bible tells of the Jews' defeat in the War of the Philistines. During the war, the Philistines seized the Ark of the Covenant, which contained the Ten Commandments. In late 2012, archaeologists unearthed a pitcher and a level of ashes, and the pitcher was found to date from 1050 BCE, and is also strengthening the assessment that the biblical account of the battle, as the assumption that Shiloh was destroying a war, are accurate. Both the archaeological remains and the Bible indicate that the Jews resettled Shiloh after the War of the Philistines. Although it lost its distinction as the seat of the tabernacle and government in 1050 BCE, Shiloh remained a major Jewish town for the next 1100 years. It survived the destruction of the First Temple in 586 BCE and the Great Revolt against Rome in 670 CE, which ended in the destruction of Jerusalem. Shiloh's residents participated in the Bar Kochba Revolt of 132 to 135. The Jews of Shiloh, like the Jews of surrounding towns, were murdered by the Roman legions following the Bar Kochba's defeat, like its surrounding communities of Beit El Levona, Eli, and Ophrah. Among dozens of others, Shiloh's reconstitution after the 1967 Six-Day War was a fulfillment for the mandate for Palestine. The pitcher, Palestinian theft of Jewish artifacts. The pitcher found in the layer of ashes at Tel Shiloh was stolen a week after its discovery was made public. The identity of the thieves is unknown, but the theft, which was removed, additional proof the accuracy of the biblical account of Shiloh's history is in keeping what has become a routine Palestinian practice of destroying Jewish archaeological sites. For instance, on October 1st, 2000, shortly after the launch of the Palestinian Terror War, a Palestinian mob attacked Joseph's tomb in Nablus with the backing of the Palestinian security forces. The rioters shot an Israeli border guard who was part of the security detail assigned to the holy site. Palestinian security commanders refused to allow his medical evacuation. As a consequence, 19-year-old Corporal Mahadat Yusuf bled to death at Joseph's tomb. Israeli forces abandoned the site after receiving guarantees from Palestinian security command officers they would protect it. But just 2 hours after the IDF withdrew, the Palestinians raided the site and burned the books and the yeshiva inside. 3 days later, the Palestinians repainted the dome roof on the top as they prepared to transform it into a mosque. The site has suffered from the Palestinian campaign of cultural and historic theft has been the Temple Mount. Following the 1967 Six-Day War, in an act of unprecedented national self-abnegation, Israeli authorities allowed the Islamic Trust Religions, or Wafa, to retain control of Temple Mount, which the IDF had just liberated from Jordanian occupation forces. The Temple Mount is the most important archaeological site in Israel. It is the holiest site in Judaism. According to Jewish tradition, the Temple Mount is where the world was created. It is also where Abraham bound Isaac. And, as the historical record proves, the Temple Mount is a site of the Jewish people's first and second temples. Since 1967, the Wahaf has repeatedly carried out unauthorized constructed activities beneath the Temple Mount in a bid to transform the cavernous area into a massive mosque. These unauthorized buildings have caused immense destruction of antiques, including sacred articles, as well as prosaics from the first and second temple periods and from the Byzantine period as well. According to Dr. Mordecai Keder, an Arab studies expert from Bar-Ilan University, these actions are being carried out in the context of a practice known as in Arabic as Tams el-Mahamra. An expression means erasing the signs in the sense of destroying the relics of all cultures that preceded Islam. Beginning in 1995, the WAF embarked on what became a four-year undertaking coordinated with the Hamas-aligned Israeli Islamic movement to destroy archaeological remains of Jewish temples. Over that period, the WAF removed some 300 truckloads or 10,000 tons of earth filled with priceless artifacts and unloaded the earth at a municipal garbage dump in Kidron Valley and in other locations outside the old city. In December 2004, Private Ir David Foundation founded an unprecedented archaeological endeavor led by archaeologists from Bar Ilan University. Volunteers began shifting through the 10,000 tons of debris from Temple Mount, and debris was transferred from the city garbage dumps to the Tursim Valley National Park at the foot of Mount Scopus overlooking the Temple Mount. By late 2006, the volunteers had discovered relics from the first and second temple periods from prehistoric times, like 10,000-year-old flint tools and from the times of the Jesuits and Canaanite periods of the Iron Age. Had it not been for the financial assistance of international donors and the labors of regular Israelis from all walks of life who volunteered to shift through the rubble by hand, the relics would have been lost forever. The Palestinian campaign against Jerusalem is unquestionably the most offensive example of their ill intentions towards Israel and the Jewish people. The destruction of Temple Mount is a cultural crime, certainly no damaging the Taliban's destruction of the ancient Buddhist Bayamon statues in Afghanistan in March 2001. And yet, while UNESCO, like much of the rest of the world, united in condemning the Taliban, UNESCO has joined the Palestinians and the wider Islamic world in their campaign to erase the Jewish history of Jerusalem. But these efforts are doomed to fail. On any almost daily basis, new historical evidence of the historical centrality to Jerusalem to the Jews and the Jews of Jerusalem is uncovered. For example, in December 2010, archaeologists discovered a drainage canal beneath an ancient street linking the original city of Jerusalem, David City, and the Temple Mount. The ancient street has been only partially excavated, and by excavating the sewer, archaeologists were able to ascertain with certainty the path of the road above. As Ronnie Reich from the Israeli Antiques Authority explained to Fox News, the channel and the street reaffirm the existence of Jewish life of the Jewish city of the Temple City founded 2,000 years ago. The archaeologists found also evidence that the sewer was used as an escape route for Jews fleeing the Roman army that overran the city in 70 CE. Among other artifacts found at the site were the remains of food eaten by Jews hiding from the Romans in the sewage canal. The history of Jewish settlement in Israel. Just as thousands of Jews volunteered their time to shift through the rubble of Temple Mount to preserve what otherwise would have been destroyed by the WAF, so during the 1800 years between the destruction of the Second Temple and the Second Jewish Commonwealth and the establishment of the State of Israel, Jews have tenaciously maintained a presence in Israel, often in the face of massive hardship and persecution. At no time have there been no Jews in the land of Israel. And whenever the Jews had the opportunity to return to Israel in significant numbers, they did. According to Joseph, the Romans forcibly exiled some 70,000 Jews to the land of Israel after the Bar Kochba rebellion. But for several centuries, the onset of Roman rule, the Jews nonetheless remained a majority of the population in the land of Israel. The centers of Jewish life during this period were in Galilee, southern Judea, and the coastal plain. According to the historian Michael Avi Yolna, after the defeat of Bar Kochba rebellion, Jews remained three-quarters of the population of Galilee and a quarter of the population of the coastal plain of Judea. During the Byzantine period, Jews suffered from massive persecution. After Bar Kochba and his army were defeated, the number of Jewish settlements in the land of Israel stood at 200. By the end of the Byzantine period, only 50 remained. The Jewish population dwindled from 750,000 to 850,000 at the start of the Christian conquest to 150,000, or 10% of the population, when it ended. During the Islamic conquest, with the institution of the laws of Omar, which forced all non-Muslims to be subservient status as dhimmis, the Jewish population of Israel dwindled still further. The prohibited land taxes levied on non-Muslims during this period forced Jews to abandon agriculture and settle in the cities. The main population centers for Jews were Jerusalem, Hebron, Rapha, Havia, Acre, and Tyre. During the Crusader conquest of the land of Israel, the Jews' positions worsened even further. Due to the Crusaders' campaign of expulsion and massacre, the Jewish population in the land of Israel had dwindled to fewer than 2,000 by the late 19th century. The historian Moshe Gil has documented accounts by Jews who referred to the Crusader oppression and massacre as nothing short of the destruction of the Jewish population in Palestine. During the Mamluk period, from 1291 to 1517, the land of Israel, for the first time, developed a large Muslim majority as a massive of Arabs fleeing the Mongol invasion of Arabia settled there. The small Jewish population remained concentrated in the major cities of Jerusalem, Hebron, Gaza, Tibris, Bitshein, Rimmel, and Safed. The Jews' position improved and their numbers expanded during the Ottoman period from 1517 to 1917. The Ottoman Turks permitted Jews who had been expelled from Spain to settle in Israel. At the outset of the Ottoman regime, there were 6,000 Jews in Israel, an overall population of 300,000, accounting for just 2% of the population. By 1907, the British consul in Jerusalem estimated there were 100,000 Jews in the land of Israel out of a population of 400,000 or 450,000. As a result, on the eve of World War I, Jews made up a higher percentage of the population in Israel than they did in any other country. By the dawn of modern Zionism, Jews already comprised majority of the population of Jerusalem, and there were large growing Jewish communities in Hebron, Tiberias, and Safed. The people of Israel, and indeed the Jewish people worldwide, are a community of memory. The reconstruction of the Jewish state in the land of Israel is an unprecedented historic compliment. No other indigenous people has preserved its national identity for so long and such against great odds, only to repatriate itself to its historic homelands and sometimes with the help of nations around the world, sometimes in defense of their collective will. The magnitude of the Jews' accomplishment in reestablishing their state is remarkable. Palestinians' obscene attempt to distort this accomplishment and destroy the historic record. Through their collective memory and their tenacious, stubborn attachment to the land of Israel, Jews preserved their national rights, and it was in recognition of this remarkable feat that in 1922, the nations of the world determined the legal right to sovereignty over the land of Israel belongs to the Jewish people alone. Okay, thank you.